Good morning, everyone, to the session. Thank you for joining us on the Urban 6 Billion. I'd like to start by just introducing our panel. My right is Michael Berkowitz, who is the director of the Rockefeller's Foundation's 100 Resilient Cities Program and works a lot on both economic and environmental and other stresses to cities. On my left is Bridget Rosewell. And Bridget is the founder of Volterra Partners, an economic consultancy, and before that, she was the chief economic advisor to the Greater London Authority. And to my far left is Charlie Garner, and Charlie is the principal of the CIM Group, which is an investor in both real estate and infrastructure investments. So thank you for joining us. I'd like to kick off by maybe just framing some of the trends in urbanization, and then opening it up to the panel for a discussion and to the audience for a discussion. So if we could run some of the slides, that would be great. Three key points we wanted to make just to frame the issue. The first was that we are at an unprecedented point in history in terms of the pace of urbanization. And this is some work that's been done at NYU that says in 1900, the pace of urbanization was under 10 million a year. Right now, about 60 to 70 million people move each year or are born each year into urban environments. That's about the size of the entire United Kingdom being added to urban environments every year. And that trend is going to slow down again. So if you go to the second slide, there is a beginning and an end to urbanization. At the beginning of the 1800s, only about 3% of the population was urban. By the end of this century, the estimates are that we'll be at about 80% urban populations, and things will round off at that point. You do need some agrarian population to support it. And right now, we're at this cusp where the pace at which this change is happening is faster than ever before and faster than will ever happen again. And finally, we wanted to sort of show how that effect varies from region. There's already been a massive wave of urbanization in most of the developed world. And in the next 10, 15 years, much of the urbanization, in terms of the sheer numbers of people, will be in Asia and in Africa. But there is creeping urbanization in North America and Europe, and a change in what an urban lifestyle means in these countries. So it's very much a phenomenon that's happening in both developed and developing countries. Maybe with that background, Bridget, I'll turn to you first. It does seem the world is fragmenting. We began with the developing countries. We then broke them up into emerging markets and frontier markets. We then looked at the BRICS. Now we recognize each of the BRICS on a different path, Brazil versus Russia versus India versus China. And increasingly, people are now looking at cities. It seems to be in the zeitgeist, the city as the sort of foundational unit of analysis. Why is that, and why does that make sense?
I think the main reason it makes sense is that cities are the place where you can engage in change. So in a stable world, and you can see this in some of the data, In the stable economy that we used to believe we lived in the 50s, 60s, maybe even into the 70s, you could see things were moved out of cities, certainly in the developed world, and people therefore thought about that for the developing, because it was stable, you could work out how to run it most efficiently, least resources required, you could specialise. In a changing world, you can't do that. In a changing world, people need to get together to work out how to meet the challenges that they're seeing. It's changing technology, changing demographics, changing accessibility, the globalized world in which we are now living in. That raises challenges which you can only deal with by getting together. And guess what? Cities is where you get together. So it's that capacity to create resilience by making it possible to deal with challenges that I think cities give. And that's why cities, which were deeply unfashionable when I was being trained as an economist, and nobody talked about cities. They talked about little market towns. They thought about dividing everybody up. They talked about de-suburbanization, all that kind of stuff. Nobody talks about that anymore. Of course, you could just say it's fashion, but I don't think so. I think it's about rising to the challenge of change.
Maybe looking a little bit at the risks in cities, Michael, and then turning to the opportunities there. We've probably all seen the clips from Kathmandu in Nepal, yeah, of the earthquake and the fact that that probably wasn't in some ways the most resilient to at least that environmental shock. But give us your perspective on, as you've certainly canvassed the world, looked at the city lens, what are the big risks to cities and what helps them thrive versus fail?
Well, you look at it, there are three sort of big trends that lead to risk. Some of them are also opportunities, but globalization, urbanization, and climate change are three. So globalization, that not only are we living in cities, but we're more connected than we ever have been before. So what happens in Dakar, Senegal, or Monrovia can easily be exported to Washington or London or Kigali, Rwanda. I mean, the cities are connected in really meaningful ways, both in terms of data, but also in terms of people and goods. Urbanization, you've covered off pretty nicely, but partly this is about the pace of people moving into cities and the infrastructure not being able to keep up with it. I think Kathmandu, I heard this morning, had almost doubled its population over the last decade. So part of the risk that Kathmandu had, it was incredibly seismically exposed because of the fault. It had terrible soil quality, but also because of the infrastructure that was just not able to keep up with a doubling of the population. And then climate change. You see where our cities are located, on deltas, on coastlines, and the pace of climate change that's driving people into the cities because the farms and the rural areas don't work quite as well. All of those things make cities more at risk.
And then from an opportunity lens, Charlie, clearly something you look at on behalf of your clients' capital. What do you see as the drivers of opportunity in a city, and how do you compare the macro view of a city and the opportunities in it with the micro drivers of a particular supply and demand equation for a particular piece of property or infrastructure?
Sure. So we focus mostly on North America. The suburban suburbanization trend after World War II has now reversed itself. And we really, I think it's hard to believe, 20-something years ago, we started focusing on urban investment as a discipline. And I think in the U.S., that probably put us on the front end of that trend. And we've been doing it for the last 20-plus years. And what we found is there are a lot of opportunities in the city. From a macro perspective, you want to find cities that are heading in the right direction, population growth, improving demographics. And there are opportunities for pretty much every product type in the real estate spectrum, but also in the infrastructure side. And we started focusing on infrastructure a number of years ago, a lot in response to some of the things we saw going on in places like Southern California, where water was scarce, and we started focusing on that. But also in some of the northeastern cities, the same things. But really, it's a different discipline. There are a different set of risk rewards, and we think that in addition to the macro, you really need to focus on the micro.
Bridget, we talked a little bit when we were chatting earlier on what makes cities distinctive and how each city is unique. Tell me a little more about that.
Well, how long have you got? Because to all of that distinctiveness, of course, is very is hard to lay out. But I think it comes down to a mix of different elements of characteristics. So one characteristic is, if you like, governance, politics, legal systems. Those are obviously very important. Property rights, kind of thing that Charlie will worry about if he buys something. Can he sell it again? Has he got title? And title is one of the really important things in infrastructure and in real estate more generally. So that's one aspect which makes different kinds of cities distinct. As an economist, I could be expected to say there's that thing about comparative advantage and specialization. I think that's actually less important than we used to think it was. There's a guy called Ricardo Hausmann, some of you may come across. He talks about diversity and specialization, and I think that's very powerful. So bigger, better, stronger cities will do more different things. They may have particular strengths, but they will also do more things. Countries, cities that are only specialized in one thing are very much more at risk. Just look at Detroit, for example, in North America. But it's also true for resource-rich cities trying to export just one commodity. So diversity versus specialization, that's another kind of dimension of distinctiveness. And I suppose the third dimension of distinctiveness is what I might call openness. And I think that's the other aspect which is really important. So I don't want to say it's sort of multiculturalism, because I think that's a bit of an overused term, but openness is about being willing to welcome people who can make a contribution. It's also being willing to trade and being able to export and import. Self-sufficiency is being a peasant, okay? The history of becoming richer as a society and as a species is the history of trade and being able to engage with other parts of the world. It may be we've got to the point where we need fire breaks between some of that globalization, so things to stop infection, you know, traveling, whether financial or indeed real infection, viruses traveling at the speed of an aeroplane. But nonetheless, that is the history that has made us all better off. So that degree of openness, I think, is the third set. So diversity and specialization, how over-reliant are you on any one thing? About law and politics and governance, and about openness and trade. And I suppose underlying that, the infrastructure which makes all that possible. I do a lot of work on transport systems, so I can't forget to mention transport.
I guess one thing that leads me to, I think we should come back to private investors and what they can do in this, but two topics I'd love to hit with all of you before we get there is, one, the role of government, and the role of technology in all of this. Maybe, Michael, from your perspective, in terms of the role of government, we'll come back to what private investors do. But as you look at cities that are resilient, that you want to make more resilient, how important is government? How important are corporations? How important is civil society?
Yeah, I think the short answer is they're all important. And I think it's worthwhile clarifying here that when I talk about cities, and I'd ask this to my fellow panelists as well, I'm not talking about municipal governments. Mm-hmm. Those are two different things. Cities are the entire ecosystem, civil society, the private sector, and the various levels of government that make a thing work. I think government is an important player in that, but certainly, as Bridget mentioned, the diverse economy, having access to diverse and meaningful jobs at all levels of skill, that's an important part of a resilient city, a successful city. And the government surely isn't going to do that on its own. So I do think that all of those sectors are really important. And we see this inclusive, what you're calling openness, we call it inclusiveness. But okay. It's this, but you're absolutely right that those are also successful cities. We've seen, you look at the Arab Spring cities, that had sort of two different populations, that one that didn't see itself as a part of the narrative of the city. What happened, one fruit vendor in Tunis sets himself on fire, and that ripples because of this lack of openness or inclusiveness, among other things. So,
but you see, if you take institutions of government, for example, the UK is one of the most centralized systems in the developed world. So the municipal government has very, very little power. It has some influence, but very little power. One of the things that changed for London in the early 2000s is that they re-established a city government. So, again, with not terribly much power, but only about 5% of government spending in London is controlled by the mayor. But nonetheless, having that focus enabled us to make changes and to win projects for the city, which would not have been possible otherwise.
Yeah.
Because of this siloed, don't start me, I can bore for Britain on this one. And now, because of that success in London, that's re-energizing city governments in Manchester, in Liverpool, in Stoke, in cities that have been depressed since the end of the industrial empire, if you like, that actually sustained them for a long while. So it may not, I absolutely agree, it's not the only thing.
Yes.
And that's actually the problem. It's you need things in all of these dimensions. Economists tend to think, what drives this? Yeah. I want to look for one thing, and it's not one thing. But that aspect of it is very important.
Can I just, one quick point to that? I think that's what I took when you talked about governance. It's aligning the incentives and the responsibility in the right ways. And we could spend some time, maybe we'll get there. But that's a huge differentiator when you look at Indian cities, for instance, which are incredibly largely disempowered vis-a-vis their Western counterparts. You see a real difference in how cities are governed and where the incentives are. I think that's a big piece of the differentiator.
And I suppose the corruption element that creeps in sometimes when you don't have strong governance and you don't have strong property rights, that's one of the other aspects that you need. I mean, Nigeria, for example, is really held back by the fact that you can't be clear where your money's going.
Yeah.
I mean, the corruption angle is interesting there. As an investor who's putting money to work, when you see a project where there is major government involvement, do you see that as more complicated, less complicated, better, worse?
It depends. Now, you look at, we were talking earlier. I mean, when you look at what we do in our approach, we do what we call qualifying communities. And you know, it's a very rigorous approach. Takes us, you know, maybe on the fast side, 6 months, could take 5 years or more. And you know, we look at a number of things. You know, we look at, touch on all of them and then come back to the governance piece. But you know, we look at improving demographics. We look at public commitment consistent with our views. You know, we look at some underserved real estate niche. We want to see other private investors. And then really what's important is also the ability to put a lot of capital into work in those markets. And for us, that's $100 million or more of opportunistic equity. So when you come back to the governance piece, we spend a lot of time, and maybe some of the most time, understanding what is the form of government there? Who really controls the decisions and the purse strings? Mm. You know, do you have a one-time mayor or governor who has all these great ideas but doesn't have the political capital to stay with it or the control to make it happen? And so it really is, you know, a very micro analysis. I mean, we even get in and go meet with the building inspectors and the planning departments, really trying to understand all, you know, how does that macro translate on the ground in the micro? Mm-hmm. And, you know, we look at 20-year histories, which is a good indicator of the future, not the only one, but certainly weighs heavily into how do you turn this into a successful, risk-adjusted investment.
I mean, Bridget, U.S. versus mm-hmm. European infrastructure is a good example, where in the U.S., yeah. I think in most sectors, it's hard to make big infrastructure investments as a private investor without some kind of public-private partnership. There are a few examples. I think LaGuardia Central Terminal was an arrangement where the private sector has been brought in, but they don't need to be owners in the same way. But by and large, there's been a history of public-private partnership. In the UK, you do see Gatwick, Heathrow, other examples where it's been a little more private sector driven. I know you have a point of view on that.
It is very interesting. Well, one of the reasons why you can have Gatwick and Heathrow as very private sector oriented companies is because the government constrains the supply. Okay, so how difficult, I mean, I don't know if any of you have read about the continuing row about where to put a new runway for London and the South East. Are we short of capacity? You bet. We've been short of capacity for 20 years. Can we solve this problem? No, it's a political problem. But it makes Gatwick and Heathrow very profitable for the private sector. So you can't separate these things, actually, is what that tells you. So, and if you talk about roads, one of the big arguments would be, well, could you toll all the roads, all the major roads, so that you can then invest in them and bring private money in because you'd have a guaranteed revenue? You can do that in some countries. I don't think it's ever going to be politically possible in the UK, nor has it proved very easy to do in the US, in spite of a rather different attitude to people making money out of infrastructure. And if you come to public transport, buses and railways, of course it gets still more complicated. There isn't a railroad system, I think, in the world, at least not a system, bits of it, but no system in the world that runs without some public investment and subsidy from general taxation. Working out the principles around which you might involve public money or not public money and how you split that up is something that I've been trying to get engagement with in the right decision-making areas for 20 years, and it's an extremely difficult thing to do. One of the problems is that government sees risk very differently to the way the private sector sees risk. So although you can talk glibly about risk transfer between the public and the private sector, the size of the balance sheets are very different. We experimented with public-private partnerships for the underground in London, and these collapsed. They collapsed basically because people set up special purpose vehicles to do the underground piece, which simply didn't have the balance sheet to deal with risk when different elements of it went wrong. It was absolutely fine, so long as everything worked according to the contract. But of course, life's not like that. 30-year contracts, please. So, in fact, all of that was unwound, and all of these assets were turned back into public sector assets. So there's big difficulty in specifying a contract which gives security of revenue to a private sector investor. We've done it with power in the UK. We've done it with water, actually, in the UK. But even that is now becoming a bit unraveling, because once you say you don't have enough supply and you want to increase capacity, how are you going to manage that with the rate of return? Because the capacity constraint is what guaranteed your rate of return in the first place. And I don't think that we've really kind of grasped that for developed economies, let alone how you manage that in developing economies where the need for the capacity of the system is much, much greater.
I do like the idea of GATRO, though. If Gatwick and Israel keep expanding the way they are, we may end up
with they were one company. They were forced to sell. They were forced to sell Gatwick by the competition authorities.
On the technology side, Michael, maybe turning to you, one hears a lot about smart cities, about the fact that in the developing world, you do rely a lot more on cell phone technology given the state of the public infrastructure that the government's put down in landlines. You hear about cities like Kansas and Bristol that have kind of laid optic networks to increase the speed of this. And from the private sector, we'll come back to it a little more. You hear about opportunities in broadband and data centers and so on. How do you think about technology when you think about, entering into a partnership with a city and making it resilient?
So we work a lot with the developing world, with both. So just to my organization, 100 Resilient Cities, we're working with 100 cities around the world, about, 60-40 developing to developed. So we're not either or. But, partly the smart cities, I'm of two minds in some ways. I see a lot of examples of how toys get purchased in the name of smart cities and don't solve the underlying issues and aren't done in a holistic way. And so that's the one warning light that flashes at me. On the other side, we see lots of great examples of cities using data and technology to better understand their needs, their opportunities, to better communicate in broad ways the opportunities or risks that are out there, so people can adjust their own lifestyles. All of that is really, really powerful stuff. And I was in the Bloomberg administration in New York City government in the first, in the early 2000s, and we rolled out 311, the one call. And it's basically a phone bank for cities, and that was revolutionary. You used to call one of 63 different hotlines to get either garbage service or complain about your neighbors or whatever those things were, foul odor or ask about street cleaning or whatever. And all of a sudden, we consolidated those and we ran the city in a completely different way. So it was magical. But I also think that the road to those good intentions is rife with a bunch of mistakes and toys being bought.
I think the big technology questions actually aren't about that aspect of it. They're more about the capacity management for infrastructure systems. So whether that's traffic light management, so you can smooth flows, or it's capacity management on rail and bus systems also. And the other big technology thing for cities is clean cities. And that's about cars and buses and electric power and all of those sorts of things. So, and driverless cars and those sorts of things are the technology changes I think will make the biggest difference to cities and make them, my other plea was, I was talking about this earlier, can we make cities walkable? So, because that's the other thing about energy use and efficient cities. You've got to be able to walk around it. I have to say, I went out yesterday to try and have a walk and it was dreadful. Couldn't find a sidewalk to walk on, let alone a bit of greenery to walk in. It was all fenced off. I discovered it was the Los Angeles Country Club. What can I say?
So Bridget, on that note, it's interesting. There are a lot of good data out there, both informative, what's happened before or now, and then also predictive. But we use our pipeline meeting every Monday morning. We go. Somebody always says, "What's the walk score of that property?" Mm. And there are a bunch of different metrics like that available, readily available. I think Milken Institute puts out a aging demographic website. The AARP has got one, but there are a lot of good data like that. But I think also hand in hand with the technology is the innovation that we see, and I think it's probably more of a driver for near-term investment in cities from the private side. And you don't have to look any further than New York City and what's going on with things like cleaning up Madison Square Park, the World Trade Center redevelopment, the Fulton Transit Hub, just the High Line. I mean, it just goes on and on. And you look at all of the development that these have spurred, and we've tried to be early on to take advantage of really what in the private side translates into, if we're right and they're right, the city and these things do transform, ought to lower the risk of investment and increase the return. And their technology, I think, is good and it's a helpful piece of all that, but you're really where the rubber meets the road a lot of times is local government, local stakeholders making things happen.
And you now have the data available to look at the number of venture capital firms in a company, the number of patents that have been issued, the number of technology-oriented universities in the city. Does that kind of macro lens feed into decisions around real estate and infrastructure among your investors?
Absolutely. I mean, you look at what's happening with Houston these days with oil, and we've started looking a lot more at how cities are diversified. What's the base? Go wind the clock back to 06, 07 with Orange County and the home mortgage business. Mm. You're really looking for more diverse cities. What's going on again in Manhattan today with technology and sort of that marriage of technology and finance in one place as opposed to, technology in the San Francisco Bay Area where finance, there's a lot there, but not nearly as much as New York. Yeah. So we clearly focus a lot on that, and it's really both helping to understand, where a market has been and is today, but also the predictive side, where it's going tomorrow.
Bridget, these were a couple of examples in terms of just patent data and so on, but one of the things I've witnessed is just much more data to your point about the fact that cities have become the unit of analysis. The richness of city-level data now versus 10, 15 years ago seems to be much richer, whether it's GDP growth rates by city, population growth rates, or crime rates, education rates, pollution rates, attractiveness to expats. How do you see all this sort of very rich new data on cities shaping how people think about opportunities from an investor lens?
Well, I'm sure it does, but I think the macro-micro stress here is really important, because what do we mean by a city? Sorry to get boring and statistical about this, but actually, generally speaking, the data gets collected on a governance unit. So it'll be the city as defined for government purposes. Not totally true in the US, where you have some standard statistical definitions of a city, but across the rest of the world, this is simply not true. So if I want to compare London and Paris, for example, I have to decide, well, which definition am I going to use? Because the city of Paris is actually very small compared to the city, well, not compared to the city of London, which is tiny, tiny, but to the Greater London Authority, for example, is much bigger. It's about 8 million people. So now I can look at, okay, so what's my equivalent for Greater Paris? And there is a sort of definition that you use. But you have to think, is it got the same economic meaning? So what do you think about as a functional city is very different. And if I go back to London, people commute into London every day from well outside the boundaries, the administrative boundaries of London. So then if I'm thinking about infrastructure, well, what is the value that's being created? How am I capturing that? Where are the taxes being raised and spent if it's a government thing? How is the return being generated? So you need to actually, I think, we need to think a bit more cleverly as well about what is this data? What are we talking about? If you go and live in London, what do you mean by that? Do you mean you're going to live in the centre of London? Or are you going to jump outside into villages around it and then get the train in? If you think about Los Angeles, I think this is the only polycentric or successful polycentric city that really I know. And given how long it took you to get here from the airport, maybe not that great.
Yeah.
So.
And given your walk experience.
Yeah, and
this
given
morning,
my walk
right,
experience.
Is it that successful?
Exactly.
We can show you a lot of really good areas around LA.
Yeah, no, I'm sure you can. Absolutely. So there are areas. Exactly. It's polycentric. So, I think we've got lots of data, But the trouble with data is how you interpret it, and the devil is usually in the detail. So I think we've all got to get a little bit more sophisticated about what definitions we're taking for that data, and in particular, what geographies we're using. Yeah. Are we talking about Los Angeles, or are we talking about Santa Monica? Are we talking about London, or are we talking about Woking?
I would take that point and just take it up a notch that it's not just about the data, it's the, you know, what defines a city. I was in the first deputy mayor, the Blasio administration just released the big one NYC plan that sort of stakes out some very ambitious goals for what New York City should look like and how they should reduce waste to landfill by 90% and reduce poverty. And there are a lot of thoughts on the benefits of this plan. But New York is about as powerful a municipality as there is. It's five counties. They control their entire water infrastructure from the reservoirs all the way through distribution. They have 40,000 sworn police officers, the world's seventh largest army. And I'm in Tony Shores' office. He's the first deputy mayor there. And he's complaining, I don't control enough of my own destiny. You know, I have to work with the surrounding counties and the Port Authority and the MTA. And the governor doesn't want to put money in, you know, and the mayor will carry the water for it and all of these things. And so if New York feels disempowered, think about what poor little Bangalore, where it's nothing, or Da Nang, Vietnam, or any one of these other cities. And so the ability of cities to see themselves and to operate in soft coalitions, in regional structures, in various governance, I think that's going to be important. And the more that we who work with cities help both empower cities, but make that bit clear, I think that's going to be a really important thing if cities are going to continue to be a successful paradigm to view the world.
It applies to countries as well, though, doesn't it? That in a globalized world, countries operate in coalitions and in relationships. Speaking of, we have a coalition government, as you may know, we've got a general election next week. And we've had a coalition government for 5 years, and we're probably going to get another one. And this is a really new experience for us. We haven't had one of these things for a long, long while. And that is in itself changing the political debate about, if you like, soft power and hard power. And maybe that's the way the whole world is going, except maybe in China. I don't know. Perhaps that's too big a subject for the moment. But actually, if we think about, take that back into Chinese cities, and say a city like Shanghai, and it comes back to what we mean by the city as well. So I went to do a seminar for them on transportation policy, and they were talking about their policy to have satellite cities around the edge of Shanghai. Each satellite would have 10 million people in it, and they wanted about five of them. So the kind of construct of density, and they wanted to get rid of bicycles because the bicycles got in the way of the cars. And there were the rest of us thinking from developed cities in the West, thinking, No. The bicycles are really good. That's what you should be aiming for, more bicycles, not trying to get rid of them. So still very different trajectories in different kinds of city. And they're building roads.
I'd like to, I know there's a series of discussions going on across the conference on urbanization and cities. And I wanted to pivot the last part of this discussion back to the private investor at the midst of these trends. Maybe bring it back to kind of just the unprecedented scale that both Michael mentioned and the data we shared earlier sort of talked about around people moving to cities and this sort of 20-year window where you are having a very fast increase in cities in Asia and Africa, and you're having this urban revival in a lot of European and certainly U.S. cities. Against that backdrop, maybe Charlie, starting with you, what do you see as the set of opportunities that you would look at, and how would you think about tackling them?
Sure. So I think a lot of it really revolves around, on the real estate side, places to live, places to work, places to play. And we've seen a lot of those places to work out in the suburbs or in the city, and the places to live in the opposite place. We've seen in New York where people are trying to move into the city. It's expensive, so affordable housing gets to be a big issue in and around New York. And I think there are a lot of good things going on. You're seeing just some phenomenal growth in places like Brooklyn, Astoria, Queens, near spots, some of them one subway stop away from downtown or from the west east side.
So do you break down the city into these sort of micro clusters? Is that kind of the way you think about it?
We do. We think about it, though. I mean, I think I was looking, we have our qualified communities. I think we have 18 here in L.A. I mean, we've got probably, I think, 12 in New York that we like and want to spend time and money and invest in. But it really is, it's interesting. You got to have a macro view of what's going on in the MSA to really understand what the impact is going to be on this investment. And, you know, we've been watching Brooklyn in particular, you know, I would say if you wind back 5 years, our big move was down to World Trade Center, Fulton Street area. And I think that's now come into fruition with Condé Nast moving down there. And we're doing both residential and office down there. But we're watching things like Brooklyn, where as the prices in New York went up, and depending on where you guys are from, some of these will sound good and some will sound bad, but the prices for housing went from, you know, 1,000 to 2,000 to 3,000 and up per square foot in New York, and Brooklyn's $1,000, which, you know, may be one of the better individual investments you can make in the whole New York metro area today because there's so many good things going on. But I think understanding those, you know, micro trends is really important.
But how can you do that without understanding what the governance side of it is at the same time, not just at the micro level? So my example, which I was just thinking about when you were talking about Brooklyn, which I know a little bit about, but is also about, so we're building high-speed rail in the UK, and there's a row about where to put the stations. So one of the rows is that to put the station should go where you can connect with more other bits of railway. Okay, so it becomes a transport hub, and all kinds of amazing claims are made for how many jobs you could create there, blah, blah, blah. A little bit down the road, there's a city called Stoke, which is been depressed for ages, was a major centre of the potteries industry. Potteries industry went away, and they've never really managed to get anything back. Again, not being diversified enough. You could put the station there. And around that, you've already got people there. You've got lots of investment in trying to invest in their skills. So you've been depressed for about 30 years now. So there's a kind of macro and micro tension there between what the locality wants and needs. My interest is I'm working for Stoke and trying to get the station put in the city centre. And if you like, this sort of macro transport need. So don't you have to understand that as well to understand your micro section?
Sure. Sure, you do. And if you look at Washington, D.C.'s metro system, there were some decisions made, I'm going to say, 30 years ago on in the Roslyn-Ballston corridor. They could have put it right up the middle of 60, a little bit different than your question, but they could have put it right up the middle of I-66, which would have been the inexpensive way to do it, or right through the middle of each of these little downtowns.
Yeah.
And they bit the bullet, and they did it right down the middle of all those little downtowns and are concentrating density around each of those stations.
And it's working.
And it's working really well.
I think our risk is we're going to make the wrong decision, but yeah. That's national politics for you.
Mike, what do you see as the role a private investor can play in cities, I guess mainly in developing markets from the lens you look at things from? And ones that have the chance to return attractive returns for their capital of their shareholders as well.
So I do think that investors asking the larger questions about, you know, both in terms of scale, as Bridget mentioned, but also in terms of what does this do holistically to the city, to see those connections is important. So that's one thing. Second is, you know, from my point of view, I have a little selfish point of view, which is around resilience to, you know, both disasters as well as chronic stresses. You know, we've seen a number of private investors asking this resilience question. When I was at Deutsche Bank, we actually selected our third Indian outsourcing site, Jaipur, based on the resilience qualities. I mean, there are lots of other, you know, availability of resources and labor and cost and transport and so on. But on the ability, the way Jaipur and the state of Rajasthan took seriously these questions of resilience. And so from my perspective, having investors ask those questions really creates a self-sustaining, you know, makes the return on investment that a city is going to make real, because it gets to attract people based on its resilience. So those are the two aspects, I think, considering it holistically, but also making sure to ask those questions.
One of the things we've been grappling at Prudential, Bridget, has been on the fact that the city lens by nature cuts across asset classes. I mean, there are lots of opportunities in real estate and infrastructure, but equally it affects kind of the middle class and opportunities in terms of the rising middle class and their changing needs as they move to city areas. It has implications for the agricultural sector. If you have 1 billion less people over the course of the century in rural areas, that will probably mean the mechanization and change of the supply chain in Asia and Africa. But from an investor lens, what's your sense of how should investors think about something when they're so typically and often organized by asset class around something that's holistic and cuts across it as sort of a mega trend across a lot of different typical investor buckets?
Get out of the silo, basically, isn't it? And I think that's, in fact, absolutely what we have to do. And that applies to, you know, asset and liability committees, and it applies to governments. One of the things that you can do in a city is we've all really been saying, everything that we've said is all about you have to look at all aspects of the system to see whether it's likely to work and whether it's likely to evolve in a successful way. So I think really what we're doing here, analytically, and indeed you can see this in the way academic studies are also evolving, I think, is to say that the reductionist model is no longer really working for us. The reductionist model is precisely the Enlightenment mechanistic model, in which you can divide everything up into this lever pulls that and this pushes the other, and we can separate it all off into our silos and examine each asset class or each driver of some change individually and separately. I think we've got to get away from that. I don't think it works for us. And it doesn't work because of the interrelationship between things, which we have increased. Globalization has increased, but also technology in itself has increased that interdependence. So if you want to have a success, if you want the Prudential to go on for another 100 years or so, I can't think quite how old the Prudential is, but it's quite old. I think then actually focusing on identifying those linkages and feedbacks is actually where you will discover the single investments. And I'll invest in Charlie, because that's effectively what you're doing. So I think that's absolutely the right thing to do. Think about the macro picture, but then you've got to get into the interactions down in the corners.
Yeah. It's interesting. I said early on, we specialize in urban investing. And so, you know, we look at a piece of property and say, what should it be? Not, we're an office investor, how do I make it office, or how do I make it residential? And that changes from time to time. And I think being able to have, it takes a lot more people on our staff to be generalist in across the country in different markets and different asset classes. But we think it really reduces the risk and increases the potential return of the investment, because we're urban focused, and we're product agnostic.
I think this is a good good time to open the floor to the audience for questions.
Let's
start from the front. Do we need to wait for the mic, or?
Yes, please.
Because they need to record this as well, don't they? So we need to make sure that people outside this room were able to hear us.
And if you could just keep the questions fairly brief, just because we have just a few more minutes left.
Yeah, I just have a very quick question. Trash wasn't discussed, which I guess is I'm just wondering to what extent is it an issue? Big cities like London, I know in the US, obviously you don't separate at all, but also I'd be very interested to hear from you kind of how is it an issue in Bangalore? How is it an issue in Vietnam, et cetera?
Yeah. You want to take several questions and then we'll do them together. It might be quicker.
Could everyone just reflect a little bit on the role of anchor institutions like research universities and medical centers in terms of what we're talking about here today?
I wanted to follow on Bridget's comment that it's not the short-term technologies like data and sensors, but the longer-term technologies like autonomous vehicles, electricity storage, et cetera, that will have a huge impact on these cities. And so my question is, how do you change federal policy and spending to be able to accommodate this long-term view rather than the short-term?
Why don't we stop there and take answers, because my ability to remember all these.
And I haven't got a pen, so yes.
This is a very, very good. Maybe Mike, begin with you and the waste question.
Sure. So when you, it's clearly becoming more of an issue. I mentioned briefly that de Blasio put out this plan, One NYC, that has really put a stake in the ground around 90% reduction of waste to landfill by 2050, and it caught the press and the public's fancy over the last few days, and a lot of the counterpoint of, is it possible, is it worth it, and so on. And I happen to like plans with ambitious goals, even if there's not a clear, I's dotted, T's crossed route to get there just yet. I like putting that marker in the ground, and we're trying to push other cities to do the same on other kinds of issues. The other thing, my mind went, and this demonstrates some of the silo problems with cities and the resilience question, is we often see this in the developing world, that trash doesn't get collected properly. It gets in drainage. The rains come, causes flooding, causes disease. And if you think about that value chain, it's trash is collected on a municipal or sometimes sub, like at a borough or a ward level in cities. And then, flood control is done at a municipal or regional level. And then public health, in the developing world in particular, is largely done at the national level, although some sophisticated cities do it as well. And if you could only collect that trash, right, you would capture that value through that chain. But the problem is with those silos in the different places makes that, accounting for that very, very difficult. And that's one of the things we're trying to help cities, not just municipal governments, but cities, understand and capture.
Yeah, I think you'll see more and more that trash becomes an asset for some, whether it's power or energy. There are a lot of different technologies going on now that on our infrastructure side, we're very keen on watching. But, you take something that's a problem and somebody like us can turn it into an opportunity.
The thread that seems to me to run through some aspects of these questions is the innovation word, whether it's long-term changes in underlying technologies, some of which are really hard, well, impossible to predict, actually, but some of which come back to anchor institutions and what their purpose is. And it seems to me that, again, there isn't one set of anchor institutions, be it research university or a hospital and research around that hospital. What we need is that mix of institutions and the ability of one to talk to one another, which comes back exactly to your point around the trash side of things. Anything that is going to exist in a sort of hermetically sealed environment, it doesn't touch the sides. Cities work when there are interconnections. So the anchor organisation, say if you take the Silicon Valley and the role of Stanford in producing all of those spin-offs, but then also in increase in actually facilitating a different kind of ecosystem around the finance side for Silicon Valley, which then drove it off in other directions and created new firms. And they've gone up different technology trajectories, and when each one runs out, they've invented something else. Whether that will eventually stop, frankly, I don't know, but it has meant that they've needed to reinvest in lots of other different kinds of technologies and different kinds of innovation. That actually, to my mind, is the great strength of the American economy. It's why America remains the largest economy, why the output per head is massively higher than everywhere else. China is going to really struggle to catch up with that. And it is about that ability and willingness to spread out from any particular research into other kinds of products. So I absolutely agree that research is at the center of many of these sorts of things and finding, catching the next wave, if you like. And cities are about trying to work out how you catch the next wave, and indeed where it is.
Maybe one question to each of the panelists, but from a slightly different angle in each case, which is specific cities that inspire you or excite you or seem as opportunities from your areas. And maybe, Michael, starting from your lens, from the resilient city lens, I know you've done a couple of waves of the program, but you'll clearly soon have 100 to choose from, given the name of the program.
Yeah.
Which two or three would you say are success stories, and what's made them work, or what gives you hope about them in the future?
So, One that certainly comes to mind is New Orleans. One of the things we try to do is to get cities to understand the connections between the different things that they're trying to struggle with and to address them in some interesting holistic ways. And, you know, New Orleans, you know, is clearly worried about the next Katrina, but it's also dealing with a massive public health, large public health problems, particularly around obesity and those sort of chronic issues, and murder and violence. And at first you think of those three things as very separate things, but when you start to overlay locations that are blighted still from Katrina, the place where you have the biggest public health problems and the place where you have murder and violence, you start to see they're in largely the same neighborhoods. And then you start to think about what solutions are out there around public space and planning, parks that can absorb stormwater, that can create places to recreate and improve public health, and that create communities where people, you know, you have more people on the streets drives down murder and violence. You'll still need cops to do murder, you'll still need docs to do public health, and you'll still need planners. But the way that New Orleans is approaching it, I think, is really, and this mayor, Mitch Landrieu, I think has the right perspective and the vision for that. Again, and this maybe goes to this long and short-term question that was raised, he's only got a couple more years. You know, he's just reelected, but, you know, his clock is really ticking now. And so to do the kinds of stuff that really changes the city, that's a generational struggle. And so how does he hand that mantle off? So that's, New Orleans is one that really inspires me. Another one that comes to mind is Porto Alegre. It's a city of 2-3 million people in the southernmost part of Brazil. And it's where what's called participatory budgeting started. So every year, from the ground up, starting in 17 different wards, the citizens decide a portion of the discretionary spending, how it should be allocated, and really do it from the ground up. And so, you know, a lot of the unrest that you saw in Brazil pre-World Cup and all that, where you saw the outpouring in the streets of Sao Paulo and so on, didn't happen as much in Porto Alegre. There's a little of it, but people feel much more engaged in some ways. And there are definitely pros and cons with participatory budgeting, but it is a really powerful and meaningful way to involve citizenry in the spending decisions. And so that is another, I think, city that inspires me.
From your perspective, if you were to reconvene, I'm sure we'd reconvene next year, but we reconvened 5 years from now, which would be the cities that you think we'd be excited about and why?
Well, I'm still excited about London. Maybe that's because where I come from, and indeed I read a book called Reinventing London a couple of years ago, so I'm still very focused on that. Why is it exciting? It's exciting because it continues to reinvent itself. And I think it's that capacity which is the most interesting thing about cities. So, it was seen as a city of finance, actually never particularly really was in terms of employment, but in any case, the way that it's now reinventing into services, into technology, into tech city, how that works, how that changes, how much it's not led by anything to do with government, but by private sector investors and startups, and how you get change to both happen and then bring it on. That is the process, and the feedback in that is what excites me wherever I see it. And I observe it most easily on my doorstep in London, so that's exciting.
From your perspective, and you probably don't have I guess your investors don't always have a 30-year horizon, but still a 5 to 7 year horizon. What excites you in terms of opportunities from a macro perspective?
Sure. I think I'll break it into two groups. I mean, there are some of the large cities, what's going on in New York, San Francisco, Bay Area, and in particular, Oakland. Mm-hmm. And then also right here in LA. A lot of good things going on. But then if you look at the smaller cities, the ones I think will be on people's radar screen more next cycle, Denver, Austin, and Nashville. Mm. And you look at so the drivers there and the local governance, it's really, they're all, you know, very, you know, pro-business and engaging with the community, to make their cities a better place to live, work, and play.
Great. Well, Denver, Austin, Nashville, London, Porto Alegre, and New Orleans. thank you very much to the panelists for coming, and thank you all for joining the session.